الحمد لله رب العالمين وبه نستعين على أمور الدنيا والدين، وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. ما بعد، my name is عبد الرحمن جاية شيلو. I'll take you in a lesson in form 4 pillars of iman, third topic of form 4 pillars of iman. It is the third topic of Form 4. As you know, IRE has 8 topics in each class, and each class you learn pillars of Iman. So in Form 4, you learn the 6th pillar of Iman, which is Qadr and Qadha. The 6th pillar of Iman. The other five you have learned in the previous classes, the previous forms. In form 4, you learn Qadr and Qadha. So it's only that one that you learn in form 4. Before I go to Qadr and Qadha, I would like to remind you the pillars of Iman that you have learned in the previous classes, form 1, form 2, form 3, so that I connect the things. Because the IRE topics, they are connected to one another. Because this is the 6th pillar, maybe someone is not aware or is not much familiar with the other 5 pillars of Iman. So briefly, and I will discuss about that one, the previous pillars of Iman that you have learned in the previous classes, before I come to Qadr and Qadha. I will only just pass to remind you what you learned there, the content that you learned there, so that you will easily remember this content I have learned in that class. When I need to revise, I will go back to that class. So, pillars of Iman, form 1, you learn the first pillar of Iman, which is Al-Imanu Billahi. Al-Iman Billahi. Before I go to that one, pillars of Iman, it is compulsory for each and every person who is Muslim to believe. To believe these 6 pillars. It is there in the Quran, it is there in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, and it is a compulsory thing to each and every person. Each and every person, when he became a Muslim, that is when he is being required to believe in the pillars of Iman so that he will get the rank of the mu'min. Muslim and mu'min is different. So mu'min has higher rank than Muslim. The person, when he says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammad Rasulullah, when he declares that there is no Lord to be worshipped other than Allah, and Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, he will become a Muslim. So he will be required to do the other pillars of Islam. Lakini mu'min, the person when he strives, when he believes in Allah, when he gets taqwa, that's when he will get, when he will reach that rank. So it is there in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, second to last. آمن الرسول بما أنزل إليه من ربه والمؤمنون كل آمن بالله وملائكته بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر. That ayah talks about the pillars of Iman. And also it is in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. For example, the long hadith in Arba'in Nawu, I think it is the second hadith, which Angel Jibril came to the Prophet ﷺ while the Prophet ﷺ is seated with his Sahaba to teach about them the religion. Also, that hadith also discusses pillars of Iman. That hadith which says, بينما نحن جلوس عند رسول الله ذات يوم اضل علينا رجل شديد بياض الثياب شديد سواد الشعر لا يرى عليه أثر السفر ولا يعرف منا أحد حتى جلس إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فأسند ركبتيه إلى ركبتيه. The narrator of the hadith, which is Umar bin Khattab, talks about that one. That Jibril came in form of human being while the Prophet ﷺ is seated with the Sahabas to teach them the religion, teach them about their religion. So he came to the Prophet ﷺ and asked the pillars of Islam, pillars of Iman, pillars of Ihsan, the Day of Judgment, in form of the questions. And the Prophet ﷺ answered it while the Sahabas there. They are there with him. so that the Sahaba also could benefit from the Prophet and Jibril. So in that hadith, the second question was that اخبرني عن الإيمان. Tell me more about the Iman. The Prophet said, الإيمان أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر وبالقدر خيره وشره. So it is there in the hadith of the Prophet and it is there in the Quran, the pillars of Iman. And it is compulsory upon each and every person to believe. Because if the person fails to believe, he will not enter the paradise if the person fails to believe the pillars of Iman. So the first one is the pillars and tu'mina billah, believe in Allah. So that is believe in Allah, the oneness, that is tawhid. As you learn in form one, tawhid. Out of these categories of the tawhid is the oneness of Allah. Worship only one God, unity of Allah. That's what tawhid is, believe in Allah. So you also learn categories of tawhid, that is tawhid rububiyyah, that God is the one who created the world, everything that is there, what is there in the existence, anything that is in the heaven, in the earth, is the God who has created. And he's the one who provides, he's the king, all those is tawhid rububiyyah. All of this tawhid uluhiyyah, that is rububiyyah. All of this tawhid uluhiyyah is the one who deserves the worship. Sacrifice, everything, worship, pray, Allah is the one who deserves it. All of the other three, the third category of tawhid is the tawhid al-asma wa sifat. Asma or sifat, that is the names and the attributes of Allah. Names of the attributes of Allah is the person he has to know also. That is the categories of the tawhid. You have learned in form one. Allah, you learn also the significance of the tawhid. In form one. Significance of tawhid. Significance of the tawhid. That it is the fundamental principle of Islam. It gives a person courage, because when you believe that there's only one Lord to be worshipped, you will have courage anything to do. You will be contented. You know that God is the one who provides. You will be contented what you have. So you will not have worries. So those are the importance of the tawhid. So also you learn in form one, if the person fails to believe one God, and he came with polytheism, worshipping more God, that's called shirk. You learn also in form one. You also learn that one in form one. That's associating anything with Lord. Associating anything with Lord. That's what shirk is. So these are also types of the shirk. These are types of shirk. So shirk has also categories. There's a shirk called Akbar. Akbar. This is major shirk. That is associating anything with Allah. Whether it is worship, whether it is the creation, and whether even it is the names, the sifat and the names God has, if you give to someone else, that is shirk, shirkul akbar. Whereas if you worship someone else, that is tawhid al-uluhiyyah, that is shirkul akbar. If you fear anything more than you fear Allah, or if you say that is the someone or somebody or something provide me something, yes, instead of God is the one who is the Razzaq, who is the provider, all those is the shirkul akbar. Yes. There is a shirkul askar. Askar, this is doing the ibadah to show off or to gain fame and even or honor. Or you do the ibadah to show off, or others to see you. Riya, it's called riya. It's called riya. So you do the ibadah that you do, you don't worship for the sake of Allah. You pay sadaqah so that to be seen. You pray salah, you wake up, you do tahajjud so that to be praised. You read the Quran in a nice voice so that to be heard. And to be said that, mashallah, Sheikh has a nice voice. That's, you do that ibadah to show off. That is shirkul asghar. Alafu shirkul khafi. Shirkul Khafi is to feel discontented what God has provided you. This is to be discontented what God has provided you. You are not contented what God has made you, what has given you. If God has made you rich, you have to be contented with it. If God has made you poor, you have to be contented. If God has made you man, you have to be contented with it. The others even wanasema laiti kama ningekuwa na mwanamke, ama mwanamke anasema laiti kama ningekuwa na mwanaume. God has made you a man or a woman, you have to be contented with it. So that's Shirkul Asghar. So this one thing, this manifestation of Shirkul Akbar. Manifestation of Shirkul Akbar, it is the classification of Shirkul Akbar. It is like five. There's a Shirkul, Shirkul Da'a. Is to worship Allah or to obey Allah more than you pay anything, to pay something other than Allah. There's a Shirkul Mahabba. Is to love something or somebody more than you love Allah. It's Shirkul Khawf. To fear something or somebody more than you fear Allah. There is a Shirkul Isti'ana. Is to ask help or assistance other than Allah. Because it's the God, it's the one that you are required to ask assistance and anything. Because every time when you are praying, we say, Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. We only worship you alone and we ask or we seek help from you alone. So when you seek help, you have to seek only from Allah. Shirk da'a, muhabba, khawf, isti'ana, and du'a. Du'a is to ask anything or to pray anything other than Allah. So that is the manifestation of Shirkul Akbar. You know, so that is what you learned. Tawheed in form one. There is a belief in Allah. I love this other thing. The second one is you also learn in form one, which is belief in angels. Al-imanu billah wa malaikati. Belief in angels. So you learn the characteristic of the angels. Characteristic of the angels, that they are created from light. They don't eat or drink. They don't sleep. They have certain duties. So those are the characteristics of the angels. You also learn the angels, certain angels and their duties. Names of certain angels and their duties. Like Jibril is for the wahi, yes. Mikael is for the rain. Israel is there. Israel is for the soul. Take the souls of the living things. Raphael is for the trumpet. Munkar and Nakir asking questions in the grave. Raqib and Atid recording the good and bad deeds of the mankind. Allah. Ridwan have the key of the paradise. Those are the certain angels and their duties. You learn in there. All of you learn the significance of the believing in angels. Hello? That's their significance. Is like that. You know the power of God. But God has created that angel which is big like that. Hello? So, believing Raqib and Atid, which ask you questions in the grave, you will be questioned of your deeds. You will be questioned of how your preparation in the day of judgment. By believing Munkar and Nakir, which ask questions in the Raqib and Atid, which is on your shoulders, you'll be questioned of your deeds. That's the significance of the belief in the angels. Alafu, pillars of Iman form two. So pillars of Iman form two is the third one, which is believe in books. Believes in the books of Allah. So you have to believe them, the books that God has revealed to their specific prophet, like the Suhuf, Torah, Injil, Zabur, and Quran. You have to believe all of them. You have to believe all the books. Yes. And you have to believe all these books to the prophets that they are given. You have to believe them. But you have to follow the commandment of God, or the commandment of the Quran. Because Quran summarizes what is being taught in the other prophet, in the other books. So if you go to the Injil, which is the book of Isa alayhi salam, the Christians, the one that they have and they have distorted, if you say that is the book that God has revealed and I will believe that one, it is wrong. You believe I will follow the commandment, it's wrong. You believe the books, but you follow the commandment of the Quran, because it's the last book of Allah that you are supposed to follow. It is commandment. Yes. So also in form two, you learn they believe in the believe in prophets. Believe in the prophet. So you where this is where you learn the difference between Nabi, which is the prophet, and Rasul, messenger. The difference. Because kullu nabi, kullu rasul nabi, wa laysa kullu nabi rasul. Every rasul is a nabi, but not every nabi is a prophet, is a rasul. This in English is prophet, and this is messenger. Person when he's been given the guidance, whether it's in dream inspiration, when he's being given the guidance, he will become prophet. But when he's being given a book or he's being sent to a people, he will become a messenger. He will become a messenger. So that is the difference. So you believe in prophets. So all the prophets, there are very many, but God has mentioned it in five of them in the Quran. Yes, you have to believe the prophet. Yes, each and every prophet, the challenges that he has passed, you learn the Ulul Azm prophets. Ulul Azm prophets. Is a specific prophet which God has examined them. There are five in number. That is Nuh, Ibrahim, Isa, Musa, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yes, Nuh, Ibrahim, Isa, Musa, Dawood, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So those Ulul Azm prophets, the challenges they have passed, the challenges the prophets they have faced. Yes, that's where you learn is there, in form three, in form two. Believe in the prophets. So you also learn in form two. Believe in the, which is the fifth one. First is to believe in Allah, two, believe in the angels, three is believe in the books, four is believe in the prophet, and the fifth one is the believe in the day of judgment. Believe in the day of judgment. So, this is why you learn the day of judgment. The other names of the day of judgment, that is called Qiyama, Ghari'a, Haqa. It has a lot of other names. There are very many. It's very many. The other names of the day of judgment. I love you to learn the signs of the day of judgment. Signs of the day of judgment. The major is the major ones and the minor ones. The major ones and the minor ones, you learn them. Yes, minor ones is there. People of drinking alcohols, the zina will become very many. Yes, the knowledge will be raised because the illiterate people will become very many. So those are the minor ones. The major ones is there. Coming of Juj Majuj, coming of Prophet Isa alayhi salam, which kills Dijjal, coming of Dijjal. Yes, and the rising of the sun from the west, blowing the trumpet. That is the major signs of the day of judgment. A lot of you learn the significance of the belief in the Qiyamah. Significance of the belief in the Qiyamah also you learn in form two. So in form three, pillars of Iman, you learn any of them. In form, this is form two. So in form three, yes, in form three is the you learn the imama. Imam. Yes, there's a imam. You learn the imam. So the qualities of imam in the Sunni, yes, the person who is imam should be knowledgeable, should be righteous, yes. Also you learn the qualities of the imam in the Shia, qualities of the imam in Shia. There's a different terms of the use of the terms of the imam. How is it used? The imam is called the one who leads the prayer, the leader of the Muslims. It's called also imam. All the prophets also they call imams. The scholars, Imam Ghazali, yes, Imam Shafi'i, yes, no, it's the Imam Imam Ghazali, yes. Those are the scholars. Also, the compilers of the hadith. Compilers of hadith, they also call imams. Compilers of the hadith, they also call imams like Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim, Imam Tirmidhi. Yes, those are the compilers of the hadith. Alafu, the compilers of the school of thought. Madahib, eh? The school of thought. Like the, also, Imam Shafi'i, Malik, Hanafi, Imam Abu Hanifa. Yes, Imam Abu Malik, Imam Shafi'i, those are there. Also, you learn the imams, the compilers of the school of thought. Also, you learn them in the, yes, you learn them in Form 3. Alafu, the Shia imams, the qualities of the Shia imams, and the names of the Shia imams, you learn. Some they believe 7 and others they believe 12 imams. Starting from Ali bin Abi Talib. Yes, Nila. Yes, those are the Shia imams. The qualities that imam, they believe that the imam is ma'soom, sinless, no? Yes, and even whatever that imam says, they take it. Because hadith, when you are learning, hadith is the saying, action and silent approval of the Prophet only. Like according to Shia, it is the saying, action and silent approval of the Prophet Fatima and the imams. So they follow what the imams say. They follow what the imam say. That's what you learn in the previous classes. So I will come to the one of the form for Qadran Qadwa. Qadran Qadwa. So let us see the definition of the Qadr. Qadr, and I will see the qada. Qadr, literally, it means to measure or to estimate, or to pre-plan, to estimate, or measure, or to, yes, or to pre-plan. That's what literally it is. Yes. And Allah says, Inna kulla shayin khalaqnahu biqadr. In Surah Al-Qamar, verse 51, Allah says, Inna kulla shayin khalaqnahu biqadr. We have put everything in place by a proportion or by measure. Yes, in proportion or in and measure. Yes. So that's the literal. The technical meaning of the qadr is the technical meaning of the qadr is the, it refers to the Allah everlasting for knowledge. In executing that is that his will power to control all affairs of the universe. Yes, that's the qadr, is the Allah pre-plan. That he has already planned everything. Yes, that his will to control all the power, all everything that is in the world, affairs of the whole universe. Because everything is planned. It's planned, everything is planned. God has planned it. Yes. Pre-plan of Allah. Everything God has planned it. Because the first thing that to be created, God, that even it was created before even the heart and the heaven. The creation of the man was the last thing. God has created man after he has created the earth, the heaven, and everything that is in them. Because the trees, the mountains, the animals, these type, different types of animals, was created to serve the man. for the to help the man. They are all of them there. We need them. So God has created the earth, seven heavens, what is in between them, and the earth, seven of them, what is in between them. And the last thing to be created was the man, when already the world is ready for the man, to accept the man. So before even the creation of the earth and the heaven, God, he has created pen. In Allah khalaq al-qalam. And he was ordered, uktub ma huwa ka'in fil ard. God has ordered the man to write anything that will happen in this world. From the starting up to the end, anything, before even is 50,000 years, something like that. Scholars, they say 50,000 years. Before even the creation of the earth and the heaven, God has created pen, and he was told to write anything that will happen. And it was everything, it was preserved in Lawh al-Mahfuz. It's called the preserved table. It was preserved there. It was preserved in Lawh al-Mahfuz, the preserved table. Everything is there and preserved there. So everything that will happen in this world, God has preserved it. It is there in the Lawh al-Mahfuz. And also, when the man is being created, anything that you will face, whether anything that will happen to you, whether it is bad or good, anything that will happen to you, God has pre-planned it. Because when you are being created in the womb of your mother, when you are 120 days, God has planned for you whatever which will happen to you. Because it is in the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, hadith in Arba'in Nawu. I think it's the, is it the fourth or the third hadith. حدثنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو الصادق المصدوق إن أحدكم لا يجمع خلقه في بطن أمي 40 يوما. That hadith which talks about the creation of the man. Creation of the person in the womb of his mother. That 40 days it will be fertilized. Fertilized egg only. 40 days it will be zygote, or of embryo fetus. So when 120 days, when he has finished 120 days, ثم يرسل إليه الملك فينفخ فيه الروح ويؤمر بأربع كلمات. When the person is 120 days in the womb of the mother, that is 4 months, he will be sent a messenger, and it will write 4 things. بكتب رزقه وعمله وأجله أو شقي أو سعيد. Everything that it will happen to him, what he will eat, it was written there, as where he will die, yes, the cause of the death, بأجله كتب رزقه وعمله, everything that you do, it was also written that time. Yes, when it was 140 days. So it was, so anything that happens to you, whether it is good or bad, it was written even before you were born. When you have been only 120 days in the womb of your mother, 4 months, and the children, they born like 9 months, even 5 months before even your path, it was written anything that will happen to you. So, and so there's nothing. Everything God knows, it will happen in this world, which will happen to the person, there's nothing hidden from him. God, everything knows. In Allah la yakhfa alayhi shay'un fil ardi wala fis samaa. There's nothing that is hidden from him. So that is what qadr is. Qada is there, is judgment. Qada, this is where we derive from the name qadi, which is there qadi, which is the judge, the court of the qadi courts, the judge of the Muslims. So qada, literally it is judgment. Technically it is the divine decree or predestination. So let us see the Islamic teaching of the of qadr and qada. The Islamic teaching of the qadr and qada. So that one, and the Islamic teaching of the qadr and qada is that Allah is the supreme, it is powerful, because he's the one who controls, he has all, is the one who has planned everything in the world. So it teaches us that Yes, Islamic teaching of the Qadr and Qadha, that it teaches that, that Allah is the supreme, it is powerful, and no event will take place without his knowledge. There's nothing. Because if there's nothing which will happen in this world, every event that happened in this world, it was planned, it's already in Lawh al-Mahfud. God even has written it, he has planned it even before the creation of the world and before the creation of the earth and the heaven. So, it also teaches us that Allah is the just and mighty. Allah is just. His planet and our God is justice. Everything that person would happen to him, God has planned it. God is planet. God is just, mighty, and people are rewarded according to their deeds. Not that if the person, everything it has been planned, yes, I will do whatever I want. If you'll do whatever that you want, God is just. God is just. And each and every person, he will be rewarded what he has done. Whether it's bad, or if it is bad, it will be rewarded that bad. And if it is good, it will be rewarded by that good. فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَهُ وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَهُ. So whatever that you have done, you will see it. It also teaches us that Allah is there. Allah wishes good. Allah, God does not plan for us something bad. He has created us. Because God, when he said, Ya Ibadi, he loves us. In that ayah that is, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنِدُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Imagine of that one. God is saying, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ يَا عِبَادِي. So God is there. God is good for us. And he planned for us always something good. Yes. Wish us something good. So you have to be active and utilize your life well. This life of yours, don't say that God has planned for me everything and I will do whatever I want. God always wishes you something good. Strive, work hard, pray, and worship Allah so that you'll earn something good. Another one is that Qadr is the measure. It also teaches us that Qadr is the measure which distinguishes the matters according to Allah's will. Yes. Qadr is everything God has planned it, and it will happen into Allah's will. Man, they plan something, but the plan of God always is effective, and it will happen the way God has planned it, everything. The way God has planned it, everything. So what is the significance of the belief in Qadr? Believe in Qadr and Qadha, significance of them? Of Qadr, a significance of the believing Qadr and Qadha. Significance. One is commandment of God. Commandment of Allah. And when you do something that God has commanded you, when you do something God has commanded you, you will get reward. Yes. There's another thing is that, another significance that it helps man to know that nothing happens without the power of Allah. Nothing happens without the power of Allah. So when you know that there's nothing happens without the power of Allah, everything that happens to you, you are contented with it. Yes. It also helps us to know that man has talent and abilities as a gift from Allah. Man has the abilities. Yes. And God will not ask you more than your abilities. Man has talent. You have to strive, work hard, and to use your mind, your talent God has given you. Because it is planned for each and every person. Each and every person God has given him certain abilities and certain talents. So you have to strive to work hard and exercise your talents and to make it useful to your life and to the world. It also helps us believing in Qadr and Qadha. Also it helps as it makes Muslims to accept the reality of the life, whether it is bad or good. To accept the reality, anything that happened in the world, whether it is good or bad. You have to accept it the way it is. Because it's God has, it is not, it has, it doesn't happen, it does not happen, it doesn't happen whether you are a bad person or a good person. God has planned for you. So when you, everything, when you see something bad happens to you, you have to be patient. And when something good happens to you, you have to be thankful. When something good happens to you, you have to be thankful. So the other thing is that another importance of the belief in Qadr and Qala is that it encourages Muslims to have patience and contentment. That's the one that I've seen now. Yes. So when you know that everything God has planned for you, you not have worry. You are contented. Contentment. Everything God has planned for you. So if I become rich, God has planned for me. Alhamdulillah. If you become poor, God has planned for you. You be patient and you will earn everything. Because the Prophet said in Hadith, Ajabani Amrul Mu'min, Inna Amru Kullu Khair. The Prophet said the issue of the Muslim person, the Mu'min person, always is good. In Asabatu Sarra Sabara, in Asabatu Sarra Shakara, in Asabatu Durra. Shakara. When asabatu sarra sabar, when asabatu dhurra shakara. When something bad happens to you, to the mu'min person, he will be patient. He will show patience, and he will earn something good. He will get reward. And when something good happens to him, he will be thankful and he will get reward. So everything that the mu'min person does always is good. He will get reward. So the other thing is that it makes the Muslim to accept Allah's creation. Yes, whatever that happens, even without any question or doubt. Anything that happens, you have to. It makes another importance is that it makes the person to accept it. To accept it, whatever that happens, whether it is good or bad, and without any question or doubt. Without any question or doubt, you have to accept it. So, before I summarize my lesson, the person, he can ask himself, if there's a qadr and qada, and God has planned each and every person, whatever that he does, everything that happens to me, God has planned it before even the creation of the earth and the heaven. It has also planned it when it was 120 days, when I was 120 days in the womb of my mother. What is the need of doing the ibadah? The person will ask himself that question. Already the Sahabas, they have asked the Prophet that question. Jazahumullahu khairan. Yes, may God reward them. They have already asked that question to the Sahaba, to Allah. They said, yes, what is the need of doing the ibadah if God has planned for us everything? Why can't we only believe our destiny and we wait it whatever that happens to us? What is the need of this striving? The Prophet said, yes, you strive, work hard. God will make easy for you whatever that he has planned for you. If something bad God has planned for you, that bad things God person becomes easy for him. And if the person is being planned for something good, the good deeds will become easy for him. You'll see the person who is always stubborn. Every doing the bad things always is easy for him. Kutisha huyu, kugonga huyu, kuua huyu. It is easy for him. And the other person, you will see everything that is good is good, is easy for him. You'll read the Quran, you'll wake up in the night and pray for tahajjud. So God, each and every person has been eased what he's been created for. What God has planned for him, that's what God will make him easy for him. I will summarize my lesson in that one. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you.